crown him with many crowns, the Lamb upon his throne. Hark how the heavenly anthem drowns, all music but its own. Awake my soul and sing of him who died for thee, and hail him as thy matchless king through all eternity. Crown him the Lord of life, who triumphed o'er the grave and rose victorious in the strife for those he came to save. His glories now we sing, who died and rose on high, who died eternal life to bring and lives that death may die. Him the Lord of love, behold his hands and side, rich wounds yet visible above, in beauty glorified. No angel in the sky can fully bear that sight, but downward bends each burning eye at mystery so bright. Crown him the Lord of years, the potentate of time, creator of the rolling spheres, ineffably sublime. All hail, Redeemer,
in Psalms 47, verses 6 through 8, it says, sing praises to God, sing praises. Sing praises to our King, sing praises. For God is the King of all the earth. Sing praises with a skillful psalm. God reigns over the nations. God sits on his holy throne.
King of kings, you are my every
73 verse 28 says, "But as for me, the nearness of God is my good. I have made the Lord God my refuge, that I may tell of all your works."
As we come to this time, let's make this a little more personal today. Listen to how many times I refer to you or your or our. Have you ever thought about it? You're getting ready to participate in communing with your God, your Savior, your Father. You're getting ready to participate in the most important part of the service today. The songs that we just sang was to help you worship God. The sermon teaches you godliness and understanding. Prayer time is to bring us in union and agreement to our desires and requests and praises to God. Those are our part and the purpose of gathering together and to direct you and your attention to communion. No, this is not communion. Matter of fact, these containers, they really kind of annoy me. I don't like the sounds of them. And how many times you go to try to open one, you can't get one open. So I want you to do me a favor right now. I want you to go ahead and take the cup that you've got. I want you to go ahead and open the wafer. And then hold that, go ahead and open the juice, and go ahead and hold that as well. After I get done, then you can end up having your own time, but we'll go ahead. I want everyone to realize what you do in the next few minutes is to put you in communing with the presence of God. That sounds like a pretty big deal, doesn't it? Well, it should be. The parts of the service that I just mentioned and talked about and that we have each week is to get you to think about God, to put and make a difference in how you think about something and communing. Communing means you bring yourself into a deeper relationship. So in other words, I can just think about something, but it doesn't put you actually in communion. Communion is a much deeper thought. It puts you in that relationship back in the same position as whenever you accepted Christ as your Lord and Savior and His blood to cover your sins. The thoughts of whoever's up here leading this portion of the service is not the meditation. What I say is I can't meditate for you, Meditation is something that you do. Your meditation is what puts you in communion with your Father. The thoughts of whoever's leading this is to help you. Most of the time, whenever we get done and whoever gets done having the thoughts up here and they say the prayer, all of a sudden we have a tendency to make that prayer our same prayer and say, amen, now let me partake. Without much thought, without much prayer of yourself, which is what brings you into the time of personal communion with your Heavenly Father. So today, I will not be closing my thoughts with a prayer, because I want to encourage each of you to spend your own time in prayer and thought before you partake of the bread and of the juice. I've come to realize in the last few months that this is something that I've been actually taking and has actually become more of a ritual that I participate in rather than communion. And now it's gotten to the point where sometimes it even frustrates me when a sermon or a song or prayer time starts before I've had time to partake of my communion and have a communion time with the Lord. The last time I was up here, it was back in August 31st, and Jeff and Mary was on vacation. But at that point, I said, communion is not a ritual to be observed, but a blessing to be received. I asked the question, do you think about what takes place at communion? Or as soon as the prayer is said, you just rip open up a container and you partake without any thought? I also pointed out that down through the course of church history, there have been several discussions, arguments over communion. Who, when, why, what takes place at communion? At our baptism, the Bible teaches us that we believe that we are covered by Christ's blood. Did the water actually turn to water, turn to blood? No. But is it in God's eyes? Let me ask this question. Even though this is not the blood, and this is not the actual body of Christ, but somehow in God's eyes, when we partake, when God looks down at us, is that what he sees? Does he see his son's blood covering our sins and his body inside of us? It's my prayer that you'll start looking at this part of the service a little bit more, with a little bit more dedication, a little bit more purposeful relationship time. A time for you to commune with your Father. Because I believe God's watching each one of us right now and wanting that one-on-one time with us. He wants that relational time, that communion time. We've heard this passage many times, but do we really understand it? Or the importance of why God had it written down in his scripture of what takes place and how we should partake in communion? 1 Corinthians chapter 11, the Bible tells us that we should assess what's going on in our hearts and in our mind before we partake the Lord's Supper. Verse 27 of chapter 11 says, whoever therefore eats the bread and drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner is guilty concerning the body and the blood of the Lord. Let each one examine himself and then so eat the bread and drink the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without discerning his body eats and drinks judgment on himself. But these next two verses are very seldom read with that. That is why many of you are weak and ill, and some have died, speaking of very spiritually. But we judge ourselves truly we would not be judged. But when we are judged by the Lord, we are disciplined, so that we may not be condemned along with the world. This is your personal communion time with your Father, to allow you the opportunity to reflect, talk to God, commune with Him concerning your relationship with Him, and let Him remind you of your blessings because of Him.
All right, grab your bulletin. And inside there is an outline for today. Also want you to take your Bible. You know where we're at, Revelation chapter 19. Revelation 19. And I need you to go there, because even though it's going to be up here on the screen, there's going to be several times when I refer back to certain verses that's not going to pop up on the screen, okay? In this apocalyptic drama that has unfolded before John the Apostle, the sovereignty of God in Christ Jesus versus the fake sovereignty of the devil and his allies, it's all come to a great climax here in chapter 17, 18, and 19. The opponents in the conflict have been clearly identified by now. In this corner, weighing in fully trustworthy, is Jesus Christ and his church, okay? And in this corner over here, weighing in woefully lacking, is Satan and his henchmen. The beast, the false prophet, and the prostitute, which is the Roman government, Roman religion, Roman commercialism. Folks, I hope you understand this. The fight barely gets started and it's over. Literally. Jesus has taken out his opponent. Chapter 17 and 18 describe the defeat of Satan in Rome. Chapter 18 specifically, that we looked at last week, shows the reaction of the losing side. Keep that in mind as you read that. The city's burning. The kings weep. The merchants mourn. Why? They lost the battle. That's why. Chapter 19, which we'll look at today, shows the reaction of the victors. And in a word, here it is on your outline. Hallelujah. That's the word we see from the victors. The word means praise Jehovah. Praise Jehovah. See, the rejoicing in heaven over the downfall of Rome is a sharp contrast to the weeping and wailing of the earth over the downfall of Rome. The world sees Rome's fall as detrimental to themselves, obviously, but heaven sees Rome's fall as beneficial. The power of Satan will be bound. The good news of the gospel and salvation will be preached to the uttermost parts of the world. In fact, there are four hallelujahs shouted out in the first part of this chapter, and that's what we're going to look at today. On your outline, the first hallelujah, here we go, verses 1 and 2. Look what it says. After this, I heard what seemed to be the loud voice of a great multitude in heaven crying out, hallelujah, salvation and glory and power belong to our God, for his judgments are true and just, for he has judged the great prostitute who corrupted the earth with her immorality, and he has avenged on her the blood of his servants. John says, after this. Well, after what? After the fall of Rome, he heard these voices. Okay, folks? After the fall of Rome, this loud voice from the multitude of heaven was crying out, hallelujah. The question that we ask ourselves is this. Well, who is this great multitude that's crying out, hallelujah? You have three options on your outline. We'll start with the narrowest group, and we'll work our way up to the broadest group, and you'll have to decide who you think it is, okay? But it could be, number one, the martyred saints that were under the altar that you see in chapter 6 when the fifth seal is broken. Remember that? John breaks the angel breaks the fifth seal, and he sees under the altar these martyred souls, and where they crying out, oh Lord, how long before we are justified and avenged for those who killed us? It might be just those people. I definitely believe they are included in this multitude that John hears. I do not believe that it's as limited just to them. I'll tell you why in a moment. Also, number two, it could be the 144,000 of chapter 7, which represents all Christians in that day and age. Because all true Christians, folks, let's face it, they would rejoice at the fall of Rome. I mean, even if you survived it, wouldn't you want it to end? If you survived the persecution, wouldn't you still want the pressure to end? And so you'd been happy when Rome took the fall. I think that's a better option than the first one, but there's still one more I think is the best, and that is this, number three. I think it is referring to all those belonging in the heavenly realm. I think this great multitude includes the martyrs who died in the great persecution and were seen under the altar. I think it includes all the Christians who survived and were still alive on earth because they also are envisioned as being part of the heavenly realm, and they would have been excited that Rome took the fall because now their persecution has ended. I also think it includes all the angels of heaven. I think the voices of this great multitude included every single being connected with heaven, whether dead in heaven or alive here on earth. It doesn't matter. They all were included. And for good reason, folks, think about this. The martyrs under the altar cried for vengeance, and they got it. The Christians who survived wanted vindication and relief from their persecutors, and they got it. The angels in heaven who did all of God's bidding in this cosmic battle wanted to see their master glorified, and they got it. And so when Rome falls in this apocalyptic drama, all of heaven rejoices. Besides that, look at what chapter 18, verse 20 says about Rome's fall. Chapter 18, verse 20. Rejoice over her, O heaven, and you saints and apostles and prophets, for God has given judgment for you against her. All of heaven is called to rejoice at the fall of Rome. And I believe verses 1 and 2 of this scripture are saying, here's what happened. Look, the main point is this, no matter which group you think it might be, the main point is this, whether it's a small group or large group, folks, that when Rome fell, heaven in one way or another rejoiced. Why? Because they had been defeated. Technically, Satan had been defeated through Rome. Why are they crying out hallelujah? On your outline, two reasons why they're crying hallelujah. Number one, because salvation, by the way, both physical and spiritual, salvation, glory, and power belong to God. And what just happened is proof of all that. Secondly, why are they crying out hallelujah? Because his judgments are true and just. God said that he would judge Rome. He would judge the great prostitute for all that she had done, especially to his people. And he did judge Rome. And so we see that's the first hallelujah. The second hallelujah covers one verse, verse 3. And here's what it says. Once more they cried out, hallelujah. The smoke from her goes up forever and ever. Folks, this hallelujah is repeated for emphasis, and it's given to praise God for once again destroying Rome. The smoke that goes up forever and ever is not to be taken literal. This is a vision, remember? Rome did literally burn. No doubt about that. History bears that out, but she's not burning to this day. This is the language of the prophets of the Bible to describe, I think this is on your outline, it is to describe total judgment and complete destruction. This is not the only place where that type of language is used. Matter of fact, in the New Testament book of Jude, which is a very short book, so it doesn't have any chapters, Jude verse 7, Jude says, as Sodom and Gomorrah and the surrounding cities, which likewise indulge in sexual immorality and pursued unnatural desire, serve as an example by undergoing a punishment of eternal fire. Now, those cities are gone, but the vision that we're given here is that they're burning still. Why? To show complete destruction, total judgment. Listen to what God says about the nation of Edom for what she did to Judah back in the Old Testament. Isaiah 34, starting in verse 8. The Lord has a day of vengeance, a year of recompense for the cause of Zion, that would be Judah. And the streams of Edom shall be turned into pitch, her soil into sulfur, her land shall become burning pitch. Night and day it shall not be quenched. Its smoke shall go up forever. From generation to generation it shall lie waste. None shall pass through it forever and ever. Now, did Edom get wiped out? Absolutely. Did the things mentioned here literally happen? Absolutely not. The language is hyperbole. The language is exaggerated for effect. Folks, you can check me out on this. Matter of fact, I want you to check me out on this. In your Bible, when the writer describes a city or a nation burning forever, Old or New Testament, it's not to be taken literal. What's to be understood is this, that that city or that nation that is mentioned is going to be completely and utterly destroyed and serve as an example of God's judgment to others forever and ever. The example lasts forever, okay? And he describes that in the sense or in the vision of it's going to burn forever. Well, the city's not burning forever, but the judgment on it will last forever. That's what he's getting at right there. All right, the third hallelujah, verses 4 and 5. And the 24 elders and the four living creatures fell down and they worshiped God who was seated on the throne, saying, Amen, hallelujah. And from the throne came a voice saying, Praise our God, all you his servants, you who fear him, small and great. Now let me take you back a few chapters. If you remember, at the end of chapter 15, seven angels dressed in priestly garb, they're in heaven, and they come out of the inner sanctuary. You with me on this? Seven angels come out of the inner sanctuary. What's the inner sanctuary? That's where God is at. When the tabernacle was built, you had the holy place and you had the what? Holy of Holies, where God was at. When the temple was built by Solomon, that same pattern was used. In the temple proper, the temple was a huge complex, but in the temple proper, you had this one building. When you walked in, you were in the holy place. But if you went behind the curtain and only one priest could, you were in the Holy of Holies, where God was at. That's the picture we're given in chapter 15. These seven angels come out of the sanctuary where God was. And here's what I told you then. I'm sticking with this. Basically, they're having a war council. It's like they were having this meeting. And the seven angels come out of the sanctuary, and we're told that one of the four creatures, the cherubim, remember that? One of the four creatures is standing there, and as they walk by, what's he doing? He's given each angel, there's seven of them, he's given each angel a golden bowl of God's wrath to be used as a weapon. I said that back in chapter 15. And I had people catch me. Jeff, my Bible doesn't say weapon. No, it doesn't say weapon. I said it's being used as a weapon. Folks, what did they do with those? They cast them down on earth to do what? To destroy Rome. The seven bowls, the golden bowls of God's wrath, were being handed out to these people as weapons to be used against Rome. And then as soon as that happened, here's what we're told in the very last part of chapter 15. Then the sanctuary filled with smoke, so that no one could go in. That is not just related to Revelation. When the tabernacle was built in Moses' day, the tabernacle was filled, the Holy of Holies was filled with glory and smoke. God was there, no one could go in. When Solomon built the temple, the Holy of Holies was filled with smoke and God's glory so that no one could go in. What's going on here? After God has made his decision, Rome's going down, the sanctuary filled with smoke, and no one was going to go in there to intercede for Rome anymore. Time was over. Are you with me on this? That's important to understand. Because why? Because now in verses 4 and 5, we see the 24 elders and the living creatures where? Before God. Now, chapter 15 said no one could enter the sanctuary until the seven plagues were done, until judgment was done. Now, here in chapter 19, we see the cherubim and the 24 elders, who I think represent God's people, are before God. What's that telling you? Judgment is done. They can go before God again. Chapter 19, verse 4, what do you see? The sanctuary, the throne room of God is once again accessible. There's what I want you to put down. The throne room of God is accessible. The 24 elders representing the people of God and the four living creatures representing the cherubim are before the throne of God praising him. We were told that no one could enter the sanctuary until the seven plagues were finished. So with the elders and the creatures in front of God's throne again, it's telling us that the plagues are finished. It's over. Rome has been judged. Not when John's still alive, but in the vision he sees it happening, okay? That brings us to the fourth hallelujah. Verses 6 through 9, John says, Then I heard what seemed to be a voice of a great multitude, like the roar of many waters, like the sound of mighty peals of thunder, crying out, Hallelujah! For the Lord our God, the Almighty, reigns. Let us rejoice and exult and give him the glory, for the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his bride has made herself ready. It was granted her to clothe herself with fine linen, bright and pure, for the fine linen is the righteous deeds of the saints. And the angel said to me, write this, blessed are those who are invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb. And he said to me, these are the true words of God. Verse 6, this is the same voice of the same multitude that John mentions in verse 1. Same group of people, okay? I think it's all of heaven. They are continuing to praise God. The party is still going on. God has, God is, and God will forever reign, okay? And they have just been given visual evidence of that with the fall of Rome. Verse 7 compares the heavenly celebration to a wedding feast to show the jubilance that's involved in this, okay? Jewish weddings and Christian weddings involve huge celebrations. That's why there's a comparison, and that's the only reason there's a comparison made here, folks. And here's why I'm telling you that. Some Bible scholars have tried to make a doctrine from this passage that the church is not considered to be the bride of Christ yet until this happens. Well, first of all, it's already happened. But that's absolutely ridiculous. Paul lets us know in no uncertain terms that Jesus views his church and has always viewed his church as his wife. All the way back in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 22 through 23, he makes a comparison between the husband and wife with him and the church. She is his wife, and that was written way before Revelation. And there are plenty of other scriptures that prove that point. In fact, God has always used marriage as a metaphor to explain the different aspects of his relationship to his people. He looked at Israel as being his wife. He now looks at the church as being his wife. Folks, check it out. He actually had one of his prophets. Excuse me. He actually had one of his prophets, a man named Hosea, go and marry a whore and have children by her. And he had Hosea do that to be a living illustration of his relationship to Israel. Read the Old Testament book of Hosea sometimes. It is both a very weird and unique book because Hosea actually did that. And he had children by her, and he had to name his children kind of weird names. You're not my people anymore. That was the name of one of his kids. You are my people. That was the name of another kid. And they did that because God took Israel and pointed them to Hosea's marriage relationship and said, there's how you've been. You have been the unfaithful wife. Just like Hosea's wife has been unfaithful. So I'm telling you that both Old and New Testament, marriage has always been used as being a connection between God and his people. Let me read what one author wrote about this passage on the marriage and the wedding feast. He says, the victory of the Lamb and his church is an occasion of rejoicing. And so we have a wedding feast pictured. This figure gives the Lamb and his church the opportunity to rejoice in one another. This is the sole purpose of the figure. Rejoicing is the truth to be expressed here, and so a marriage feast is called on. In chapter 7 of Revelation, it was a feast of tabernacles. Here in chapter 19, it's simply shown as a marriage feast. And I can read a whole lot more and give you a dozen verses on this issue if you need it. But folks, what I want you to understand is verse 7 is not building some doctrine of when the church became the bride of Christ. The church became the bride of Christ at her inception on the day of Pentecost, period. The wedding feast comparison is simply to show you that at the fall of Rome, heaven rejoiced like people rejoice at a wedding feast, period. That's what it's showing us. Verse 8 compares the bride's clothing to the bride's deeds. Her clothing is pure and bright, which stands for the fact that her deeds are pure and righteous. Paul Butler said this. He said, the harlot, Rome, had brought ultimate pressure upon the bride of Christ to seduce her. But the bride of Christ remained faithful to her husband. It might have seemed that the whole world had been deceived and had committed fornication with the harlot, but not Christ's bride. She married him and adorned herself in the righteousness of Christ that he had provided for her. She did not dirty her garments with compromise. She did not strip them off in unfaithfulness. She is clothed in the righteousness of Christ through her deeds. All right, verse 9 blesses everyone who is invited to the marriage supper. Folks, you got to get this in your head because it's a vision. If you are a part of the church, then you are the bride. If you are the bride, then obviously you are invited to the marriage feast. Why? Because it's for you. You catch that? It's for you. The angel talking to John, assures him that everything he is writing down, all the way from the beginning of this book, both the good and the bad, it is true. And it is true because the angel says this, it is the word of God. John, every little thing you've seen from the moment this revelation started, you better trust it, you better write it down. And here's why, brother. It is from God. Verse 10. I fell down at his feet. This is John. I fell down at his feet to worship him, but he said to me, you must not do that. I'm a fellow servant with you and your brothers who hold to the testimony of Jesus. Worship God. For the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. Now, I want you to get the picture. John did not literally fall down and worship this angel. John knew better than that. He had lived physically with the Lord of the heavens for 3 years, right? In the vision, John sees himself doing what? Falling down at the feet of this angel. And in the vision, John sees himself being corrected. You must not do that. We're all fellow servants. The angels in heaven, the humans on earth are all fellow servants to God. Don't do this, John. Worship only God. That's what this is getting at. So what's the purpose of this particular vision? To teach a lesson. A powerful, important, potent lesson. And here it is. Only one is worthy. Only one is worthy. And that is God Almighty. Only He is worthy to be worshiped. Folks, and the final sentence connects Jesus to God. Under the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of the prophecy. Well, what did prophecy tell us about Jesus? He is God in the flesh. That's what prophecy tells us about Jesus. He is God in the flesh. So, folks, only one is worthy of worship, God Almighty. And He can only be worshiped through Jesus, the Son of God. That makes Christianity a very exclusive religion, which ticks the world off. And it has been that way from the beginning. Do you know that the only reason the Romans hated Christianity is because not it was a religion, it was exclusive. History bears this out. With every nation that fell to Rome, the local people were allowed to keep their own religion. As long as they also worshiped Rome and the emperor. Rome was made up of 1,000 different religions. And it was. But they also had to acknowledge Rome. Guess who would not? And folks, they paid a horrible price. I'm telling you, nothing has changed. Our world doesn't care if we worship God. But when we make it exclusive, they can't stand it. And yet Christianity, by its very nature, makes itself exclusive. Why? Because there's only one God. You military people know this. Chaplains don't get in trouble for praying to God. They get in trouble when they end the prayer in Jesus' name. Why? Well, because God is a broad term. You can make anything or anyone God. Boy, you mentioned Jesus Christ, and instantly you have narrowed it down, haven't you? And you have just made Christianity exclusive. And Christians paid that price in first century Rome, and Christians are still paying that price in the 21st century world. Solomon said this, "There's nothing new under the sun." And brothers and sisters, he was absolutely right. That's why Revelation is still pertinent to us. You look at what they went through and what Rome did to them, and you can see the exact thing happening today in many countries, and Christians going through the same thing. So endure. Endure. Why? We won. Let's stand and pray. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for the message of revelation through your Apostle John and through your Son, Jesus Christ. Thank you, Lord, for the encouragement it gives us, for the vision it gives us. Thank you for the hope that it gives us as we see how your Son took on the enemies of the world and dropped them. Father, we want to be part of his team. We want to be his bride. And he's talked about how his bride is clothed in the righteous deeds. Lord, help us to be clothed in righteous deeds because we love your Son and we stay faithful to him. Lord, we pray as we prayed earlier when Walter mentioned the different missionaries and he mentioned different people who are under persecution, when he mentioned the persecuted church around the world. Father, I believe absolutely that anywhere the church is doing your business is probably going to be persecuted. There's going to be some sort of conflict, sometimes not so tense, but sometimes pretty intent. It's not because we want it. It's because the world knows you in a way that they hate you for it. Father, help us to be as faithful as these people that we read about. Help us to be this faithful bride that we're given a picture of here in Revelation 19. Lord, it's so easy to dwell on these things and think about these things as we said here in the midst of brothers and sisters, but tomorrow it might not be so easy. Tomorrow in class, tomorrow at work, tomorrow talking to a neighbor, whatever the case may be, that's where the challenge comes. That's where we must remember whose we are. And I pray, Lord, that through today's assembly time, that through today's message, that all that's taken place here, that we will remember whose we are. Lord, we love you. And most of all, we thank you for loving us. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Our Savior. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. Judge and our defender, suffered and crucified. Forgiveness is in you. Descended into darkness, you rose in glorious light. Forever seated high. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three.